Welcome back to True Believers in the Road to Hell. We're here with Kevin Bixby. And Kevin, let me just thank you, first of all, for being here and being willing to talk on this to this amateur podcaster and share the information and your opinions with us. But also, I want to thank you for the work you've done. I know just by your reputation and the things I know about your history and about the things you talk about here today, just how valuable you are to the community. And I know you're not alone. You're not the only person, because nobody is, but you've been a driving force on a lot of these issues for many, many years. And obviously it's because you're a true believer and because you're very dedicated to these issues. And, just hearing you talk about the details of some of the things I had even considered really makes me, and I'm sure others, realize just how accomplished you are and how valuable you are to the community. So thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I want to ask you a little bit about your personal experiences. Let's go to fundraising first. You talked about that, and you've said several times, we talked about economics and there's not a lot of money in this and this and that. And I'm wondering, what is the source of your funding for your organization or for the movement generally?
Well, George Soros, he's a big sort. Just kidding. We are often accused.
I was
going to
say, George, really? I didn't know.
I'm just kidding. I wish George Soros was funny. I
don't want to say that name. You'll go up in flames, right?
But whenever people want to somehow discredit us, they always ask about who's funding us. So, but it's a valid question. Like most.
I wasn't trying to discredit you, by the way.
Right. I know. Like most nonprofits, small nonprofits, we get our funding from a variety of sources. We get some foundation grants, and they're mostly private foundations, and they're usually small grants. And then we have members, individuals who give us small amounts of money, mostly for the, and some of them have been giving us money for, 20 plus years, every year, very loyal. We don't have a lot of members, but some of them are very loyal. And then we do fundraisers, and you mentioned parties at the Bosque Park. Well, we used to have our annual gala out there.
Right.
On the river, for the river. And then we moved it downtown to the Las Cruces Plaza. So, I mean, it's by hook or by crook. And it was never ending.
One reason I ask is because obviously, as you say, this is a constant issue with all kinds of people who have the best of intentions trying to get things done, but funding is just a real challenge sometimes. This is, call me naive, which I probably am, but it seems to me that maybe if you go to the people who are, by reputation, your opponents, they have the money, don't they? I mean, they have a lot. You have some well-funded opponents, I think, in perhaps certain industries like the oil and gas industry, perhaps. I'm perhaps being stereotypical, and I'm sorry.
I think that's accurate.
But, you have ranchers and oil men and so forth. I'm wondering if there's not a funding source there somewhere for especially some of the people you described as mavericks. But that's just a suggestion. I don't really know that. It just seems like maybe there's some way that you could join arm in arm to get some of these things, get where you have at least similar goals. But I don't know.
I think it is in my 30 years, I've probably had one experience like that.
Let's go for two.
It's not a reliable source of funding.
I understand. There's a fleeting thought, you know, but anyway, you were once, I think, you used to have a radio show, didn't you? We talked about this podcast, but you have more experience in this than I do. Didn't you work for KTAL or have a program with KTAL, the local radio station, for a few years?
I did. In fact, I started the radio station, KTAL LP. What year was that? It was a while ago. Somebody emailed me, someone I'd never heard of, and said, hey, the FCC is handing out licenses for nonprofits in your area. They don't do this very often. It's for low power. That's what the LP stands for. So 100 watts max. And you should apply. I thought, oh, yeah, sure. I love democracy of media and, you know, local media. So he helped me through the application process and we got the application.
What did you learn through that process? What did you learn by doing that show?
So then I planned to host a talk show about environmental issues. And then I was approached by a gentleman, Kyle Johnson, up in Silver City, who had started a community radio station there. And they already had an environmental show like I was planning to do. It's called In Earth Matters. And he proposed, and I thought it was a good idea, that I become a co-host on that station. And it's the only show, so I did, that's what happened. I did my show once a month. There were three other co-hosts. I did it out of the Las Cruces station, but it was aired on both stations simultaneously in Silver and Las Cruces. And their show they did in Silver and it aired down here. So we had a little wider, you know, reach that way, and it wasn't, you know, doing a weekly show was way beyond my capacity because it takes a lot of work, as you know, just doing a podcast. and just preparing, I mean, imagine it's very similar to doing a radio show. I mean, it took a lot of preparation. I had to reach out to potential guests and come up with intelligent questions. And I like to run the questions. Yeah, so it's just an hour show in advance to the people to see, you know, get some feedback from them about what, if this is what they wanted to talk about. Also, so I wasn't completely unprepared, because I'm not like the best on the fly interviewer. But yeah, I mean, I did that for 3 years. I've given that up because I've moved on. I mean, I really want to focus on this Wildlife for All campaign, but it's still a show and still airs on both stations.
So what lessons have you learned over the, of course, you've got a long way to go yet, but as of today, what would you say is the top lesson you've learned about trying to get this message out there? And you started off on a pessimistic tone, saying things have gotten, there's no doubt they've gotten considerably worse over the years. But I'm wondering, you're still pounding away, I trust, because you have some optimism that you can make progress and make improvement. What's the biggest lesson you've learned about that?
Well, you know, persistence is, I mean, the odds are stacked against groups like us and advocates that are, you know, don't have a lot of resources and are just up against, you know, big money and interest. And also the weight of how, you know, the conventional thinking. But you have to persist. That's the only way you succeed. And I used to tell people I was saving the river one meeting at a time, because that's what it felt like. And that's actually probably the progress that we made was because I was able to show up so often and just year after year advocating for, you know, whatever we were advocating for. That's true of the Rio Grande. We've changed management of the Rio Grande for the better. I mean, it's not where I'd like it to be, but it's a lot better than it used to be. Those islands that you see in the river today, we fought like hell to get those islands, to keep them there, because every year when islands would become established, and because they're good wildlife habitat, and every year when islands would become established, you know, some plants would start to grow in the middle of the channel, the farmers in the irrigation district, they wanted them out. They don't like those islands at all. They think they, you know, slow down the delivery of water to their irrigation system. And so we would go and do battle before the agency that manages the river. It's called the International Boundary and Water Commission. And when we first started, there were no islands, and we weren't, and then IBWC was completely, you know, every year they get in there when the river dried up and they take out those islands. But today we have those beautiful islands, especially in the reach by the La Mancha between the I-10 bridge and the Mesilla bridge, just beautiful islands. And you know, like I mentioned, we like to canoe that stretch at night, and you'll see, I mean, tons of birds are in there, and the beaver, and it's just great wildlife habitat. So that's, you know, it's a small victory, but it's because we just showed up.
Because you know, persistence. There's a saying in law that many defenders, at least, say, which is, we're protecting the Constitution one client at a time, which is kind of what you're talking about, which is obviously true, that it takes people to do the, you know, get down in the trenches, if you will, to do the detail work one at a time. On the other hand, there's also policy prescriptions that can be made. There's statutes and there's rules and commissions and this kind of thing that have a broader impact. Is there something like that, that while you persist at one victory at a time, one meeting at a time, that is there some kind of act or policy that you're trying to have implemented, at least in New Mexico, statewide?
Well, that's a great question.
Legislative.
Yeah, we've had some victories. We were leaders on the campaign to ban coyote killing contest, and it took a while, as everything does, getting legislation passed. But we finally got it done, and now these killing contests are illegal in New Mexico. We got the trapping ban done this year, a ban on trapping on public lands in New Mexico. And those have been done in coalition with other groups. But we have our eyes on the prize of legislation that's along the lines of the Wildlife for All campaign, which would address the systemic problems in New Mexico, the same in other states with wildlife management. And the legislation, so far we haven't got it passed, but you know.
Has any state?
I don't really know the answer to that, because I haven't looked at all 50 state statutes.
Let me ask you, I'm interested in the politics of this, because I mean, I know how frustrating that whole process is, but once you get constituents or get the votes lined up, if you will, get people behind you, get the support, then sometimes you can get great things done on occasion. So I'm wondering, do you have an actual written proposal that's sponsored by a bill sponsored by someone who will has a, which what I take you to mean is you're taking a comprehensive view of wildlife management.
Yeah, it would.
Am I right?
In New Mexico, what this bill would do is declare the policy basically to align wildlife management with the public trust doctrine. So all wildlife is important for, you know, the beneficiaries should be managed this way. And then it would expand the authority of our Game and Fish Department to manage all the species in the state instead of the limited number that it has today. And this particular bill also had some funding for to do that, to take on that expanded work. That bill did not succeed. It didn't get out of Senate Conservation Committee, which was a problem for many bills last session. That's,
but you're still
inside baseball, but yeah, we're still pursuing it. Yeah. And I expect it will pass depending on how the elections go in 2022. It should pass in 2023.
Let me ask you, if you, on the negative side of things, I've asked you what lessons you've learned. You said persistence. Are there any, you know, obviously hindsight's always 2020. So if you look back and say, gosh, I wish I would have done, you know, if I'd known then what I know now, I would have done A, B, or C. Do you have any moments like that where you wish you had taken a different course to try to get some of these things done? I'm not suggesting you have to.
I'm thinking that I really can't think of any right now.
All right, that's great. So what are your aspirations, Kevin? You've said you have a really wonderful and a wonderfully large, broad aspiration about wildlife in general. But what are your aspirations for the next, I don't know, couple of decades or whatever? What's on your plate? What do you hope to accomplish in the near term or the medium? I'm talking about you personally, not for the whole world, but I mean, what do you hope to happen?
Well, I really hope to get this Wildlife for All campaign up and running and making a difference. And that's going to be my legacy. Excuse me.
Well, tell us about it, because I know you, it's very important to you, and you mentioned it. I want to make sure you have the opportunity to say anything you want about it. I don't want to cut you short on that.
I'm at the sort of the end of my career as an activist. I'm 64. We had, you know, the Southwest Environmental Center. We lost our location downtown. We lost some key staff. So, and I had been moving in this direction, gravitating towards the Wildlife for All campaign for a while. And it was a good opportunity. And then the pandemic hit too. It was a good opportunity to make the transition from Southwest Environmental Center, a regional organization, and dealing with a lot of different issues, wolves, border wall, Otero Mesa, Rio Grande restoration. To focus on this one thing. And this one thing is so important because in every state, when you try and fight these wildlife issues, you come up against this underlying, it's a systemic problem of how wildlife decisions are made. And nobody was addressing it. There was no organization that had taken that on as you know, a main top priority, or even a priority, really. So I just stepped in to fill that niche. We stepped in, we launched Wildlife for All. We actually just launched last week to the public. We've been working on it for a while. We put together a coalition.
Who is we?
There's a couple of staff people. Well, there's three of us. There's me, and there's a campaign coordinator, a campaign assistant. And then we have a board of six, and they include some local folks as well as people that are, active in this issue space, if you will, in other parts of the country. And then we have an advisory committee, which is more of the same. It's like 15 people, and they're all like basically heavyweights in this field, thinking about the need for governance reform. So that's who we is.
I understand that the primary, correct me if I'm wrong, the primary purpose of this is to, I think you've said it, is to basically have representative decision-making as opposed to disproportionate representation or in the decision-making. Am I right? And so that's a big step forward in order to getting where you ultimately want to get.
Yeah.
That's part of your...
That's part of it. That's part of it. Also to get the wildlife decision makers in every state to pivot, whether it means replacing those people or getting them to just change the way they think, from thinking of wildlife management as providing, you know, managing hunting and fishing, to primarily protecting ecosystems and species. So it's a whole different a focus of the wildlife management system in America.
Wow. Well, that's got to be both hugely rewarding and hugely challenging at the same time, I think, in terms of your aspiration, because that's, the goals are grand and righteous, and the, I guess, the road to hell in this are there's a lot of obstacles there to getting it done, but I just I admire you tremendously for doing it, and I wish you all the best and all the support you can get for reaching your goals here locally and nationwide.
Thank you.
So thank you, Kevin, for being with us here today, and good luck in reaching those aspirations.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure talking with you today.
Okay. Thank you. That'll be this segment of True Believers and the Road to Hell.